our research has focused on the fact that while there were market failures in, say, the originate and distribute model, underwriting quality, etc., there were also a large number of signals to regulators that there was a collective housing market exposure building up, especially in most of the Western economies, notably in the United States. But there was a regulatory failure that that this was building up even under the strict capital requirement regime that they had. If you contrast that with India, you could argue that even with a somewhat less of a stricter capital requirement control in the sense of Basel, etc., what the Indian regulators did recognize in 06-07 was that retail mortgage lending was becoming a collective exposure of the banking system. And they, by revising the sectoral capital requirements on the retail mortgage lending, they actually averted a very significant housing market boom and bust. So I would say in some sense there was regulatory success in India in that particular episode. Of course, there is the broader issue, which is that we just don't have enough markets of various types, corporate bond markets, various kinds of derivatives, which have developed to a point enough where corporations and banks can actually hedge and manage their risks much better. Right. I would say there is probably both a plus and a plus and a minus of having them. Right. What a unified regulator allows you to do is to take a very holistic view on the system, not just a banking view or an insurance view or a markets view. A unified regulator typically does consist of representatives from these different regulatory agencies, and they all come together and can take a holistic view. The downside is that if this unified regulator becomes, in some sense, the authoritative regulatory figure, then you might see very little regulatory innovation, which is often necessary because as the institutions change, as the markets change, the regulators have to evolve their policies.
Right.
And usually this works much better in with decentralized regulators rather than with a single central regulator. In general, historically, the banking problems have been dealt with through some support for central bank, and in case of state-owned banks, through direct sort of fiscal support of these banks. I think right now the difficulty is that the government itself is trying to reduce its fiscal deficits. And I think if banks get into capital needs, it's going to be difficult to provide sort of further financing. So I think, in a way, the situation is quite interesting right now in the sense that growth has to pick up in India fairly quickly. For that, some basic policy reforms have to come in play, especially in infrastructure. Right. Maybe FDI restrictions have to be removed on some more sectors to attract more foreign capital. And that would be a better fix for the problem rather than having a hard landing for banks and then governments need to inject capital. Given that the government is on a decent fiscal path now since the last 18 months, probably this is not a bad time to have issued these, to start thinking about issuing these bonds. Prior to that, there was clearly a lack of clear path on what the government's fiscal plans were. Even now, there are some bills, such as the food bill, that look sort of fairly expansionary as far as fiscal deficits go. And so there is some concern, but I would say in the current environment, it's probably a much better time to issue them than 18 months back.
Okay. Sir, our finance minister had expressed concern for, had expressed desire to merge few banks to make few two, three global entities. Do we need big banks or do we need more banks?
I would say we probably need both. I think we need banks who can deal with both loan books as well as bond books, market books. But we also need, absolutely need many more smaller banks, especially to reach out to the rural India. Okay.